teaching English as a foreign language presented by our School of Continuing Studies partner, Dr. Steele. We're so excited to further explore this topic in our session today. A quick couple of reminders as we get started. We are using Zoom meetings, so please feel free to send in questions as you have them using the chat area and to keep your videos on if you can and if you like, so we're all here together, create a sense of community. I'm recording this session and I'll share the recording out in a webinar follow-up email that will also include additional resources and ways to be in touch with Dr. Steele and others in the program to follow up and ask further questions. Without further ado, I'm going to go ahead and turn it over to Dr. Steele. Thank you so much for being with us today. The floor is yours. You can go ahead and kick things off.
Great. Thank you so much, Sarah. And thank you all for taking time to participate today. As we get started, I'd like to ask you to share your reasons, what drew you to this session, so that I can tailor my comments a little more closely to your interests and needs. So if you can, just put a few words in the chat, or feel free to turn on your microphones, of course.
Hi, I'm Laura Bryant. I'm a Georgetown retiree, and I retired in 2016. And then last year, I became a flight attendant. My timing was kind of bad. I graduated and earned my wings in February and flew through till the end of March and then went on leave. And I guess I was looking at a certificate program that would be of interest to me. And this one, I think, would give me the ability to travel, which of course was what I wanted to do as a flight attendant.
That is really interesting, and talk about timing. Thank you for sharing. And someone else also shared the just retired looking for new jobs / interest. That's great. Anyone else?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, my name is Paul. I live in Rio de Janeiro. So I went to the school that doesn't exist anymore, which is the School of Languages and Linguistics. And I was a Spanish and Portuguese major. At any rate, so I had lived in Brazil previously and came back here with my wife to live in Rio almost 2 years ago. And I had an intention at that time to specifically teach business people English. Only, you know, I'm semi-retired, and then the pandemic came. And then as luck would have it, a neighbor of mine, I'm going to make this long story short, he just teaches like basic people. He had an overload. He gave me a client. And so I started doing it. And now I just completely changed my whole LinkedIn profile, and I'm putting myself out there because everyone's doing everything remotely now anyway. And especially in Brazil, which is not anywhere close to the level of safety of the pandemic compared to the US. I'm just launching the idea of trying to reach business people, because that's what my career is. It's in business, it's in agribusiness, agriculture, and Brazil, this is, you know, one of the biggest markets. So I don't know how to really teach English, and that's what I'm getting up the learning curve on.
Excellent. Thank you for sharing. And if you see the chat, you'll see that you have a neighbor in Salvador, Brazil. And a few others have posted that they have done some teaching or are interested in a portable career due to relocation with school. Great. A Fulbright. It looks like a lot of people have some experience, which is excellent. Feel free to keep sharing in the chat and to jump in with questions or comments as I go along. I'm going to share a bit about the program, primarily focusing on the content and what you will learn if you enroll. And then at the end, a few administrative details about admissions, which I don't handle, but I have the overview in an email for someone if you have more specific questions. I'll start with a quick introduction of myself. I really empathize with all of you looking to travel. I've lived overseas. I love it. And coming back to the US, and as an idealist, I pivoted to working in ESL, EFL, because initially of the desire to work within the immigrant and refugee community here in the DC area, but also because it was too much of a shock to leave international cultures and reimmerse into our macro culture here in the US. And I loved being around people from all over the world. I've worked in K through 12, primarily secondary, although I've worked with teachers at younger grades, adult education, family literacy, community college and university. And I'm happy to talk further individually about any of those because there's so many options for teaching. At Georgetown, and after a while, I went back to get a PhD. After I was teaching, I had more and more questions, and I wanted to learn more about best practices and teacher culture, and I could go on and on about that, but I won't. At Georgetown, we, in addition to this program, I work within a unit that does international teacher education, and we've done programs for teachers in Panama, which is a country that's done a huge push in bilingual education. Spain, as they were working to align with the EU standards for bilingual education. Republic of Georgia, where they were doing civic education, and many other places around the world as well in mixed and country-specific groups. More recently, I've worked... I've taken a lot of professional development. It's not here, but in learning differences, people who have some learning challenges, as well as in technology, instructional design and technology. And thanks to our COVID-19 pandemic, I've spent a lot of time in the past year working with faculty who suddenly were thrust into this teaching online kind of environment. I was previously at another university through 2010, where we did, you know, early on sort of, we were pioneers in international online teacher education with like a residency seminar type program. And our program at Georgetown is structured in a very similar way, with a lot of the theory and initial work online, and then seminar style student teaching practicum toward the end of the course. So Georgetown, you're all, this is great, you're all alumni, so you know our mission. We are driven by Jesuit values and the ethic of service and internationalism. And this certificate really closely mirrors those values. And in order to train people to enact those values very, very effectively, the certificate is set up to provide a really strong theoretical foundation, experiential learning, and application best practices in planning instruction so that people are ready to work here in the US or internationally. The program outcomes are that you will have a very strong foundation in second language acquisition theories and teaching strategies to facilitate that language learning process. All of this is embedded in a student-centered approach so that you don't walk in with your textbook and what you think students should learn, but you're oriented toward the needs of the students that will be in front of you, and you take into account all of those myriad factors, cultural, linguistic, also personal motivations, professional motivations, academic motivations. Lesson planning is a big part of the program. We sort of front load the learning theory and the second language acquisition theory so that you have the conceptual framework and tools to begin enacting ideas and strategies for the classroom. And we take an objectives-based approach, an outcomes-based approach, a backwards design type approach so that you can see where you want students to be. And then you figure out the steps that you need to take so that they can achieve their goals. I was in the middle of explaining the outcomes and went through sort of the amorphous ones more concretely. By the end of the program, you will have completed a 35-hour student teaching seminar. This is the in-person part. And within that is embedded your own class, 10 hours of teaching your own class of students. We invite students from around the community, currently around the world, because this has been an online teaching situation. So a series of concentric circles. There's the online course, TEFL Online, and then the student teaching practicum for the past year has also been online. And within that, I've developed a teaching English online mini course so that students are prepared to do their student teaching online. So it's really a cool experience because student teachers have their own class of, you know, 10, 15, 20 English language learners. And after meeting them the first day and conducting a needs assessment, you will plan instruction for that class of learners. Within the seminar part of that experience, we spend a lot of time on collaboration so that everyone can learn from each other. You can share resources for lesson planning, experiences after teaching each day about what type of activities worked, ask questions of your peers, suggestions for how to improve. And that's a huge source of professional development that sometimes exists in the real world if you have a big department and lots of colleagues, and sometimes doesn't. Another key component of the program is reflection, structured reflections, and of course, personal reflections that lead up to the development of a portfolio and philosophy of teaching. Normally, those two products, and I can talk more about those if there are questions, come as the culminating projects in a master's degree program. But in developing this, back when we launched more than 10 years ago, I felt that many of the students will be coming in with professional backgrounds, possibly advanced degrees in another field, and will not take any additional training in this field. So I wanted the graduates to leave with the same products that people finishing a master's degree in TESOL or education would have. And that's a portfolio and a philosophy of teaching. In terms of program quality, we have aligned the program with our professional organizations standards for what they call standards for short-term TEFL/TESOL certificate programs, and there are five domains in there. This is really important as you're considering this career because there are a lot of TEFL certificates out there on the internet. Look carefully to make sure that they include these core components and that they are adequate to meet your needs. Some of them are as short as 60 hours and may or may not have teaching experience embedded. So I'm really proud of this program, obviously, because I've been working within this context for well over 10 years. So I explained already that there are these are considered two separate courses, but integrated into one 260-hour CEU program. The online is like a regular university semester. We start in August and end in December, or start in January and end in May, 15 weeks. During the last 5 weeks of those 15 weeks, we have the student teaching practicum on Saturdays. In the spring, there's an option to do the student teaching practicum in a one-week intensive format. So you finish the online course and then do the practicum. So for people who are living internationally, obviously that's a more realistic option with the travel and the housing and everything else. You can just come to DC for a week. Due to the pandemic, of course, no need to travel at all. You can do the online student teaching from wherever you are in the world. Let me pause there before I go more deeply into sort of how this looks online and answer questions.
Sure, so feel free to, if you have questions, send them in via the chat. Or feel free to unmute yourselves and ask them as well. Raquel, like your hand is up. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah. So with the student teacher seminar portion, what age group are the students that that the program participants would be teaching during that seminar?
That's a great question. They must be 18 or older, so they're adults.
Thank you.
Sure. Other questions?
Hi. Just to make sure I understood correctly, normally you would need to come to DC for a week, but during the pandemic, you can do it all online?
That's correct. You'll be student teaching live on Zoom with your class of 20 students as if you were working as an online English teacher. And the pandemic has created a lot of interesting questions. Of course, there will always be opportunities to travel and teach overseas, but will the amount of online teaching that we've had over the past year continue? And my hope is that it will, because it really creates even deeper global connections. I have a student who just finished the program that is working in a nonprofit organization as a volunteer with Syrian refugees online, completely online. So normally it would be quite difficult to travel to Syria, obviously, and work with displaced people or Syrians who are outside of Syria, perhaps in Jordan. And her organization is able to reach those people, and she's able to work with students in that capacity. I have another student who just finished who is Peruvian, living in Peru, and she's teaching a Washington, D.C. class from Peru, obviously, and that wouldn't have been possible for her to do pre-pandemic. My hope is that this kind of opportunity will continue to exist. But for now, in terms of the program, I'm a big fan of online education. Because of some of the for-profit fly-by-night online things that are out there, in some quarters it has a bad name, but if it is done well, set up well, communicative and interactive with a good class community, it's an excellent, excellent experience. So we will continue to have one section online, even post-pandemic. So once we're able to go back on campus, we'll have an on-campus practicum, but we will also offer as an option an online practicum for people who want experience teaching online.
Dr. Steele, may I ask a question?
Of course.
Hi, this is Rebecca. I was wondering, one thing that I've been considering, as maybe other alums are too, is the public service loan forgiveness program for student loans, and we're eligible if we're working for a nonprofit organization. And I wanted to know if this program helps with placements or helps to network to find nonprofit organizations for whom we could, you know, either work on a contractual or part-time or full-time basis. Is there any sort of help in that regard through the network, or is it pretty much like, once we get the certificate, kind of on our own, you know, we're kind of on our own?
That's a great question. As of now, we don't have any formal placement or career services associated with the program.
Okay.
What we do have, we have a LinkedIn group We have an informal network, and I put a lot of people in contact with each other.
Okay.
Based on their needs. For example, there are often people interested in legal English because they've been working in the legal profession, and yeah, there's enough of a group in that category. The same with business English, the same with K through 12 teachers. Some, even though this is not, I want to be clear that this is not a K through 12 teaching certificate. There are people that have worked as K through 12 teachers that want to learn more about working with English language learners. Right. And so they take this course, and there are every year there are a few people in that category. A lot of people do go on to nonprofit work, whether here in the DC area. We have a lot of we have public sector and nonprofit organizations working in this field to serve our local community, and then also internationally.
Great. Okay. Well, thank you so much. So it sounds like there's not a formal career services program, as you mentioned, but seems like it's a wide network with a lot of different people who have similar interests and goals. So I think, you know, at the end of the day, it probably works as a career network, maybe, hopefully.
Yes. In fact, I'm jumping forward a little bit. I'll come back and share a link to some alumni stories. There are so many, but the other thing I wanted to be sure to mention is that we use the theoretical framework, as I mentioned, and we do address each of the main skill areas: teaching, speaking, reading, writing, and listening. And throughout the course, you'll do sort of applied work in each of those areas, as well as lesson planning. But concurrently, you'll be doing classroom observations and using our conceptual framework to analyze what you have observed, and then also doing the reflective journals that will culminate in the philosophy of teaching. And the structure of coursework, I showed a snapshot of our course site from last fall. Every week, as in any graduate class, there are reading assignments. There are lectures broken into mini lectures so that you don't have to sit and listen to me for an hour. I sort of provide some information, and then there are video models, for example, showing a method of teaching speaking that leads to discussion board activity, so that all of you in the class can exchange ideas and think about how you would do that type of activity better, or what some alternatives are. It's useful to see people working in a classroom to see the theory in action, the ideas in action. So we have a pretty robust class discussion forum, and then two assignments weekly. Mainly, it's an online course. A key component is communication. And if I don't know how you're doing and what's difficult and what's easy, what you like, what you hate, I can't be as responsive as an instructor as I would like to be. So the assignments are usually small work samples, and then one of either lesson planning, class observation, or journal reflection. So it sounds like a lot, but it's a reasonable workload. And the idea of the way the course is set up is to be very, very interactive. So you don't have, so that theory informs analysis and interaction and your instruction, teaching, and reflection, and it all, it's very recursive. Everything works together. All of this prepares you well for student teaching, and I think I've talked about this already. And the instructional model, this is important, and for those of you already teaching, this might be familiar. The idea with backwards design and outcomes-based teaching that we hope that all of you will be prepared to do by the end of the program is that every single lesson you teach should have a purpose and objective, not just a set of activities like beads on a string, but activities that work to lead students to achieve an outcome. So if you have a larger curriculum, you'll break that down into sequential steps, and every class period will mean that you plan and then you do some assessment. Did students meet the objective or not? Then you reflect and review the results and think about what you need to do the next day to help them better achieve that objective or go on to the next step. So you revise and plan and assess. It's an ongoing cycle in order to be very responsive to the students. And this is just a quick snapshot of student teaching on campus, a former teacher from a few years back, and a look at class size and our volunteer students. This is an interactive class. It hasn't just gone into chaos. He's given them an activity and they're working in pairs to practice some conversation. And then online, I hope the students turn on their cameras, but sometimes they don't. And then a bit about alumni. Some have gone on to work in the nonprofit sector, either here in DC or overseas. Some are volunteers who did the program in order to improve their skills as volunteers, which is really moving and impressive. Some have gone to K through 12 or adult language schools internationally. Back here in the US, the program again is not a teaching license, but there are schools if you're interested in working in K through 12 settings. There are private and charter schools that don't require a teaching license. If you can demonstrate your skill, and your passion for teaching and student-centeredness, they will want you for sure. And then we have publicly funded programs that exist in areas of the country, metropolitan areas, where communities are interested in investing in the community of people who don't speak English as a native language. It's a very good investment because then people can improve their economic well-being and contributions and so on, their participation in society. Let's see, and this is a link I can put through the chat when we get done. I have some other links. Let me stop for program questions first before I talk about admissions. If any. I don't see anything.
You said five language skill areas. I mean, there's the obvious speaking, listening, reading, writing. What's the fifth?
I'm sorry, I forgot to say grammar. And grammar isn't really a separate skill. It infuses the others, but people, so we do grammar pedagogy and a grammar review. Why? Because everyone has had a different experience in learning grammar, whether they grew up here in the US or in another country. The pendulum in our education system has swung on teaching grammar. I got a very grammar heavy middle school education and my younger siblings did not, because the pendulum swung back to whole language teaching. So, the students have always expressed interest in learning more about grammar, how to teach grammar in a communicative way. In reality, the best grammar teaching is communicative using all those other skill areas. So grammar comes at the end. And then I have sub-skills like vocabulary and pronunciation embedded in the reading and the speaking parts of the course, respectively.
I have a question, and I apologize if you've addressed this already. Where can we find information about the tuition and fees?
That's coming right up. That's coming right up.
Oh, great. Thank you. It sounds exciting. And thank you.
I'll put the link to that part of our website in the chat as well. Okay, and that's a good transition to admission requirements. The application process is fairly simple. There's an online application on our website. With that, you'll need to submit transcripts. Electronic are fine. And then a very short personal statement, why you're applying, what you're interested in doing with the program. And then for non-native speakers, there's a very brief language exam in addition to TOEFL test scores. And then if it's an international transcript in another language, there's the evaluation, the organization that does transcript evaluation. And then when it comes time for the practicum, Georgetown will handle the F1 student visa process. So fairly straightforward on that. Deadlines and timing. I believe the application deadline is August 1st and the online course starts August 25th. And the Saturday practicum is November 6th through December 11th with a break on November 27th when the university closes for the Thanksgiving holiday. And the tuition down here is $4,350 for the fall. And our website, so I will put that through the chat at the end as well, and as well as our email link. So we have, you can write to me with any kind of question if it turns out to be, to belong in the administrative or admin side, or admission side, excuse me, I'll pass that along to our office. And with that, I'm gonna stop again for questions and pull my links.
Dr. Steele, I'm just looking at questions that came in during registration, you've covered many of them. And I know we were talking about this one before we started our presentation, but a question about kind of what are the most important parts of English to emphasize? Like for a foreigner entering into American society, what are the pieces that are the most important to emphasize? Or, you know, as folks go through the teaching English as a foreign language program, are there pieces to really hone in on and like dive into and make sure that they internalize those and make them their own as they're teaching?
Yes, that's a really broad question. I'm going to assume the question comes from the perspective of a teacher. And you know, like so much in teaching, the answer depends on the needs of the student. Of course, everybody needs a foundation in speaking in all the skill areas, right? I like a task-based approach so that students from day one, if they speak not a word, can walk out able, for example, to introduce themselves. And there's a lot that they can do even with one simple sentence structure that they can flip into questions and flip back into answers. And that student-centered, objectives-based approach works all the way up to the highest level, an executive in an oil company or a high-level official in the IMF. They will have specific needs, perhaps industry-specific language. And so it will bring in content-based instruction, outcomes-based instruction within the parameters of their workplace needs. And I don't know if that answers the question. So if the person who asked the question wants to follow up, feel free.
That's great. Thank you. A question, I think you mentioned this, you'll share the slides, correct?
Or yes, I will, so you can send them out to everyone.
Perfect, so I'll send those out as well as your contact information in the webinar follow-up email, so everyone can be on the lookout for that, as
great.
Well as information on the program.
Great. Great. So please don't be shy about contacting me, even if you have just a marginal interest. I love talking to future students, former students. I hear from students from the outset of the program, really, and when they're making career decisions or academic decisions, having difficulties in an environment. That's one of the most gratifying parts of being a teacher, is that kind of lifelong connection. And the same is true if you want to hear more, if you want to talk to someone more about the program and whether it fits your life, I'm really glad to do that. We can have a Zoom or a phone call or just an email exchange, whatever is most comfortable and convenient. Don't be shy.
I wanted to add just a comment. Not sure if this will be sort of baked into the program, but it seems that the Biden administration is supporting grants to nonprofits or any 501c3 that might want to help intending US citizens learn English and teach to the test of the citizenship exam. So perhaps you've already thought of that, but I thought I'd add that. I read that yesterday and thought that was fabulous.
That's great. I'm glad they're investing. I didn't hear that news, but the good news is the citizenship preparation courses have been around for a long time. And so that falls very neatly into the framework of task-based instruction / content-based instruction. Right here in the DC area, we have courses specifically designed for preparing for the citizenship exam.
And wonderful. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you for asking. Great question.
Is there any kind of financial assistance or scholarships for this program?
There, for Georgetown employees, there is the TAP program. Unfortunately, otherwise, there is. Let me, you know, that's not my area. There may be some kind, and Sarah, you may know, but maybe not. There may be some kind of tuition installment payment program, but I'm not aware of any scholarships per se.
Or financial aid.
Financial aid. I'm so sorry. I think there is not. But it's worth asking. It's worth writing to this GUELC@georgetown.edu. And I'm going to write myself a big note on that.
I didn't catch that address.
I'm sorry. I put it in the chat. It's
all right.
GUELC@georgetown.edu.
Thank you.
Sure. Thank you for asking. And I know it's a hefty tuition tag. Other questions?
Perfect. Well, if there are no other questions, we can move to close out, give everyone back a couple minutes in their afternoons. Dr. Steele, thank you so much for being with us and for presenting today. It's been such a pleasure working with you and learning about this program alongside everyone. And to all of our attendees, thanks for being with us. Thanks for your questions and your engagement, and hope to see many of you participate in the program.
On one last quick comment, Sarah, since a few people have asked for the slides, I can go ahead and put them in the chat as well as sending them to you to email out to people if that would be helpful.
Sure, that's great. If you don't mind doing that, absolutely.
Just one second, and here it comes.
Perfect. So you'll see the ability to download the slides right there in the chat. Like I said, I will share those in the webinar follow-up email as well, along with the recording of the session, a survey for feedback, and upcoming events from ACS and the GUAA. So thank you all so much for being with us. Dr. Steele, I'm giving you a big round of applause over here. I know everyone is at home.
Thank you all. I give you all a big round of applause for your interest in this profession. So thank you again, and hope to see or hear from some of you in the future. Take care and stay safe.
Take care. Hoya saksa.